Well, and let's start the scientific part for today. And our first talk is gradient catastrophe for multidimensional homogeneous Euler equation. And the speaker is Boris Konopelchenko. And you can.
Okay, thank you. First, I would like to thank organizers for the kind invitation to participate in this nice conference. For me, it's a real pleasure to present talk here, particularly in the presence of Andrei. I didn't have a privilege to collaborate with Andrei in the last, say, 50 years, but all discussion with him, his comments, remarks were always very useful and stimulating to me. One of the favorite topic of research of Andrei was singularity of solution of nonlinear equations. And today I would like to add something to this topic. Namely, I would like to discuss some recent results concerning the structure and properties of gradient catastrophe phenomena for the multidimensional homogeneous Euler equation. This is a joint work with Giovanni Artensa from Milan, and you can find the detail of this presentation. This paper just appeared very recently. Okay. Gradient catastrophe is a widespread phenomenon in various branches of physics and mathematics, and usually it can be described by the words that derivatives of some quantity with respect to other become infinite, blow up, while this quantity, you call it U, remain bounded. In contrast, the singularities, usual singularities of nonlinear equations. For PDEs, it's usually the fact that derivatives of dependent variables with respect to independent become infinite for positive time. And the most known example, classical example, is connected with the wave breaking presented here. You have a wave propagating from the left to right. In some point, derivatives of this tangent line become vertical, derivatives become infinite, and then you have the break. Is it happened or not depends on situation. But anyway, this fact, the derivative become infinite, is essential. This phenomena, mathematically, has been discussed for a long, long time, going back to Earl, Riemann, and many, many others. And nowadays is a part of the textbooks where partial differential equations are discussed. The main method to address the problem of gradient catastrophe is the method of characteristics. I will not discuss it here, it's standard things. And gradient catastrophe usually appears when characteristic intersects. How and when, everything is here. And the gradient catastrophe presented here as an example, breaking away, in fact, have a various appearance in physics, from astronomy to hydrodynamics and quantum physics in very unexpected fields. Classical and standard textbook example is given for this phenomenon is given by so-called Birkhoff or Riemann, other names, equation presented here. Okay, it's classical results that any solution of the Birkhoff equation, in fact, is a solution of the linear equation, Radoff equation, where fu is arbitrary function. In fact, it's just inverse of initial data. Okay, differentiated this equation with respect to x and t, we all get the following relations. And if this expression bracket is different from zero, one can easily see that u solves Birkhoff equation. Gradient catastrophe occurs clearly when this factor vanishes. And then gradient catastrophe is usually called blow up the derivative where time of catastrophe is positive. And then one can usually calculate the first appearance in gradient catastrophe, so minimum value of t. And standard textbook example is presented here. Initial data is 1 minus tangent hyperbolic tangent x, and t minimum is equal to 1. This is classical textbook example. I give it here just then to compare what happened in multidimensional case. Method of characteristics can be extended. It was extended to multidimensional systems of any order, so with any number of independent variables, any number of dependent variables where AI are matrices M by M, and characteristics are usually defined as a level set of solution of the following equation for function phi. In this case, you see this equation is nonlinear, very complicated, and difficult to solve, to address. Of course, one can ask the questions about the gradient catastrophe, but the question is simple, but answer rather complicated. And physicists, as usual, found different ways to address this problem. Let's go back to the famous paper of Zeldovich 1970, then discussed in this paper. And it was mentioned also by Kuznetsov, Spector, Zakharov, in that paper, Kuznetsov, Manakov, Santini, and something of that, this connecting with the multi-dimensional had been discussed in the talk of Zhenya Kuznetsov the first day of the conference. So there are a lot of contributions in different approaches, which are somehow equivalent, not always. Here, I would like to discuss the problem of gradient catastrophe and blow-ups for the homogeneous Euler equation presented here. Number of independent variables is arbitrary n, and it's well known that for n equal to 3 and 2, it's the most simplified version of the principal equation of serial continuous media, Navier-Stokes equation. But even in this most simplified
excuse me, the sum probably over k?
Oh, yes, thank you. I'm sorry.
Okay, thanks.
Of course. Even in such a most simplified form, when you drop up all the contribution on the right-hand side, describing different effects, this system of equation arises in various branches of physics. In addition to this physical meaning of this system, it has a remarkable property. Any solution of this, I will call it HEE, is obtainable as a solution of the following hydrograph system of consisting of n equations when Fi arbitrary function of n variables. In such a form, it has been proposed first time, long time ago by David Fairley, then discussed in Fairley and Lisnov. And in fact, it's equivalent to other approaches going back to Zeldovich with Lagrange coordinates and so on and so forth, and mentioned also by Kuznetsov talk. Due to these two facts, this system equation seems to be an excellent touchstone to the analyze and understand property of multidimensional partial differential equation, particularly multidimensional quasi-linear systems. And I will try present some result in this direction. Okay, let's start with the system of hydrographic equations and function Fi, I didn't mention, in fact, are local inverse of the initial data. Then if you differentiate the system of equations effects to variables, we end up with the following relations, where M is the following matrix with the following elements, T is the time. If determinant of M is different from zero, one can invert this relation, end up with the following formula, and one can easily see from this system that any solution of original equation and this relation solve the homogeneous order equation. It's enough to multiply this for my new K, doing sum of K, and doing sum. Okay, exactly as in the one-dimensional case. Okay, as I said, Fi is just inverse of initial data, and one can easily show, similar to a one-dimensional case, that solution of the homogeneous order equation can be represented in the following form. So this is just initial value, but which depends on n variables of the time. This means immediately the domain of variation of the solution exactly coincides with the domain of variation of initial data. The matrix M, which appeared here, in fact, is fundamental object in this discussion. One can easily show that matrix M obeys the following equation where dt is the total derivative respect to time and is identity matrix. If matrix M is invertible, one can introduce matrix U, and then for U, one obtains the following equation. In fact, has been discussed by Zhenya Kuznetsov a long time ago in his discussion of the singularities of hydrodynamical type equations and in his talk at the first day. And you see the matrix view, we have the following elements, derivatives of velocities with respect to coordinates. Okay. Things derivatives of u with respect is given here. The blow-ups appear when determinant of m equal to zero. Remember that matrix M is the following form. So determinant, in fact, is given by the following very simple equation, which is polynomial of order n with respect to t with some coefficients, which depends on u due to the function fi. Let's note that all coefficients here are real valued since we considered everything is real. And so we have the polynomial equation with real valued coefficients. In general, the solution of this equation T with respect to variables U has M branches. Let's present it in such a form where Ti correspond to the real roots of these polynomial equations. We are interested in only in real solutions, roots of this polynomial equation. And due to the standard properties of polynomial with real coefficients, we have the following facts. The maximum possible number of branches equal to n order of system number of independent variable order of the system, but minimum possible number of branches is different. It's one for n odd, one, three, five, and so on, and zero for even dimensions, two, four, six, and eight. So first, we observe this essential difference. What does it mean? That for odd dimensions, one, three, five, and so on, any solution, so for any coefficients of this polynomial equation, we have a real valid solution for T, so we have a blow up. It will be gradient catastrophe for positive time. For even dimensions, there are solutions which are blow up free because there is no real solution for T. And here I would like to fix notation. So blow up derivatives for negative time, I will call just blow up. A blow up for positive time, we'll call gradient catastrophe. In usual, according to usual definition of gradient catastrophe, you have initial data, and then you consider what happened for positive time. Okay, particular situation, we have the coalescence of branches, which is given by this equation. And in fact, this system of PDEs for function f1, fn, two branches may intersect, and the intersection is going along the hypersurface of the dimension n minus one, and so on and so forth. This hypersurface, I called it blow up hypersurface. In fact, it have different properties. If all these partial derivatives vanish, that function means the function depends only on ui, then blow up hypersurfaces have n branches separated and nonlinear and homogeneous equation decompose into m one-dimensional Burgersdorf equation. This is just trivial deduction. Now, second property. Okay, as far as concerning the gradient catastrophe, we are usually interested in the first time. Okay, it will be associated, of course, with a branch where T has a minimal value. Let's take this branch if it exists. Minimal value of T is defined by the conditions that derivatives have vanished and plus some condition for second derivatives. Generic initial data, function F, U are generic. This means we have here generic functions as the derivatives, n functions equal to zero. So relation between n function for n variable. So generically, this system have a single solution. This means that generically gradient catastrophe for nonlinear algebraic equation happened and the single time given here at the point of blow up hypersurface. And then it expands to the whole blow up hypersurface. In fact, this observation for KP or KP type equation has been done for the first time by Manakov Santini in these papers of 2008-2011. Another property concerning the blow ups of derivatives. and I will show that all derivatives blow up simultaneously. But nevertheless, there are certain linear superpositions that remain bounded. And the base effect for that is the matrix is degenerate on blow up hypersurface. In contrast to one dimensional case, on the blow up hypersurface or supposing so corresponding M is just zero, but here is matrix M is degenerate. Let's assume that matrix M has rank R. Then one can write the formula for derivatives in the following form, where M tilde is the adjugate matrix, rank of M tilde also R. In the vicinity of blow up hypersurface, where determinant vanish, we have the following expansion. Remember, the determinant M is a polynomial of order T, and the last term was just determinant of M at the blow up surface. So it will start with the order epsilon. Instead, M tilde has the following expansion starting with zero order. Combine these two expressions, one end up with the following expression for derivatives, where M tilde divided by epsilon plus terms, finite order terms of the order zero and epsilon. This means that all the derivatives for each I and K blow up simultaneously, where epsilon go to zero, more or less in the one-dimensional case. In multi-dimensional case, there is something new. Since the matrix M tilde is rank R, there are N minus R vectors of that time, such that the following relations are satisfied. And standard fact that the matrix equation with determinant equal to zero have no trivial solution. Number of solutions is just equal N minus R. Left, right side, the left side. Multiplying these relations from the right by RK doing sum, or from the left by LI doing sum and using some constant, one end up with the following relations. This means in the left we have the sum, in the right terms with R or epsilon disappear exactly due to this property. This term disappear. So what we have? Here we have the superposition where alpha beta arbitrary constants. This type of superposition is the order zero in epsilon, it's bounded. Or this type of superposition is order zero, it is bounded. This means that there exists n minus n dimensional subspaces where all the superpositional derivatives are bounded. And this property seems to be really novelty of multidimensional case. In two-dimensional case, here we have the fact that along one direction, the derivative of U are bounded. Okay, this also says that everything here depends on the rank of the matrix, on R, dimensionality of the subspace. So one have a fine structure of the gradient catastrophe to be studied, to be analyzed. In addition, if we have a corresponding constraint also, the A1, another constant vanish, the first contribution here will be of the order one over epsilon squared. So we have a high order blow up. These two all these properties indicate there are many things to do in multidimensional case to analyze the fine structure and high order blow ups for homogeneous ordinary equation. It's much richer than in one dimensional case. Okay, matrix M, in fact, can be used for many other purposes. For instance, to discuss the behavior of derivatives near the blow up hypersurfaces. Okay, let's consider the infinitesimal variation of X and U for fixed time. It's just simplification. We'll end up with the following formulas, again, with the matrix M. Remember that M is degenerate, so there are vectors R and L, which satisfy the following property. And for instance, just multiplying this relation by LI from the layer doing sum, we see the first term here that associated with it disappear. So we end up with the following relation where F tilde This is the sum of the second order derivatives. What does it mean, these two relations? It means that for certain combination of variation in certain directions, variation of u will be a square root, say so, of variation of x. This means the derivative will have singularity along these directions. In contrast, if you take here arbitrary vector, which orthogonal to Li, we end up with a relation where the first term will be important. So we will have a little relation between variation of x, variation of u, which will show there is no any singularities. These two relations shows that in multidimensional case, at least for the linear or an equation, situation is rather complicated, interesting, and study of that should be as a subject of further investigation. It was a discussion of a general situation. In one particular situation, everything simplified drastically. In the case of potential solution, potential flows, when velocity is greater than a certain function phi, this immediately can be written in the following form, which implies immediately, due to definition, that matrix M minus one is symmetric, hence the matrix M itself is symmetric too. This immediately implies that we have the following relation between derivatives, and Fi means locally at least, is a gradient of certain function W tilde, and W tilde is really valued. So for the potential case, matrix M is of the following form. So what we have, matrix M is a symmetric matrix with real elements and use the standard property of matrix. Yes, all eigenvalues of M are real. This means, remember that C in fact can be viewed as an eigenvalue of matrix M, that in this case, blow up happy surface have n real branches. All n are real. Even if some of them or all coincide or colorless, there is at least one real for any dimension n. This means that any potential solution of nonlinear of a homogeneous order equation, any dimension exhibits blow up. And it will be gradient catastrophe if time, corresponding time, is positive. It's probably interesting to know that for in this case, Hadamard equations, in fact, can be viewed as an equation for critical points for the function of that time. In other words, one can say that critical points of the function of that time where WT is arbitrary function are governed by a homogeneous order equation. Okay, now I will proceed to some examples, two and three dimensional examples. Let's introduce the following simplified notation. So X, Y, U, V, F, and G. The Hadamard equation is written as following form. A blow up hypersurface is given here, and it has a two roots given there. And blow up happens when determinant is positive or equal to zero. Li will denote this type of determinant of Wronskian as J0. I'm sorry, notation. And there are three different cases. If delta is equal to zero, there is one branch only. And if this combination of derivatives is a positive, we have a blow up in the negative, in that time, negative. If it's this combination of derivatives negative, we have a gradient catastrophe in the positive time, given here. For delta positive, there are also three cases. The first case presented here, and we have a blow up set positive default in two branches. In this case, we have gradient catastrophe, in fact, for two gradient catastrophe for two branches. If J0 is negative, we have a blow ups for in two branches. No, we have a blow up in negative branches, T minus, and gradient catastrophe event to T plus. And for yod zero equal zero, we have a blow up in these two times. It's easy to see that in the potential case when F and G are components of the gradient, delta is given here, it's always positive. So we always have blow up. Situation with in the case when delta is negative, as it was mentioned before, correspond to the case when solution and do not exhibit the blow up, it's blow up free. But in this case, it's convenient to derive homogeneous Euler equation, the total coefficient in complex form. Okay, let's, for this purpose, let's introduce the following notations, Z, capital V, and F. In these variables, two-dimensional homogeneous Euler equation assumes the following form, where bar means complex conjugation, and the Godot-Graff system is given here, and the blow-up hypersurface is given with formulation. And here F is, of course, is a complex value. Everything is complex value. And we have derivatives to V and V bar. Okay. There are two branches presented here. Not two branches, two roots presented here. And interesting to discuss some particular classes of initial data. Okay, let's start with the case when F is analytic function. And due to the relation I did not present before, one can easily see it corresponds to the analytic solution V. VZ bar is equal to zero in this case. And the homogeneous Euler equation presented in the previous Z1, if Z bar equals zero, becomes this complex Durgesov equation. It has been discussed in different contexts, for mostly for potential flows in these papers. Kuznetsov, Spector, Zakharov, Karabu, Zhuravleva, Zubarev, Karabu, in different contexts and study the solutions. In this case, one can show as a seek this term F V bar equal to zero. So inside the square root, we have the following expression, and this is just imaginary part of F, always negative square. So T plus minus always complex, and there is no blow up. For this particular choice of initial data, one can say there is no blob in the physical domain. In fact, in this paper of these two papers, and also that when it was noted, also in the talk of somehow of Kuznetsov, that in this case, singularities blobs appears on the wall or outside the physical domain. It would be interesting to understand a real connection these two facts. Another possible solution is given if we impose the following constraint on V. So V is sort of pseudo-analytic function, and this equation Beltrami equation. In fact, it defines the quasi-conformal mappings on the complex plane if the modulus of mu is less than one. It's called the complex dilatation. In this case, nonlinear and homogeneous Euler equation takes the following form. For consistency, mu should obey the following nonlinear equation. Under this constraint for F, we have the following constraint for F, very simple. O is the inverse form given here. And the blow up hypersurface is given by a very simple expression here. And you see, since all these terms are different from zero, it may happen only where modulus mu equal to one. But this is exactly coincide with the situation when the quasi-conformal mappings defined by the following equation become singular. So blow-ups in this case affects the blow-ups of the quasi-conformal associated quasi-conformal mappings described by the function V. Okay, and now some simple concrete examples. Let's start with the two-dimensional case. With the following initial data, one can easily calculate the following associated function f and g. So we have the following Hadamard equations of that form. And the variation of U and V are given here. This is inside the square. We have two branches given here, or two roots, better to say. And what we can observe, in effect, that gradient catastrophe happens, I will omit intermediate calculation, for minimal term equal 1 plus square root of 3 in the point U and V equal to 0. And we have also a blow up for T equal 1 minus square root of 2, the same point. So for this initial data, which are really two-dimensional, very special, we have a blow up in negative time, a gradient catastrophe in positive time. One can easily calculate the following, the matrix M defined before, and one can easily see on the point TC, it's of the following form. This immediately implies that the following combinational derivatives are bounded. Square root of 2 ux plus uy is bounded. Ux and uy blow ups simultaneously, both of them, but this combination remain bounded. Also that, this and that. So this means that in two-dimensional case, is for this initial data, all derivatives blow up, but there are particular directions here. So along the vector fields square root of dx plus dy, derivative remain bounded, and here, and as well, this combination of derivatives of u and v also becomes remain bounded. This phenomena, of course, is phenomena which appear only in two dimensions, in absolutely absent in one dimension. Now let's consider another example for u0, v0 given here, where epsilon is a parameter. It can be viewed as a sort of one plus epsilon dimensional case. Since for epsilon equals zero, these terms disappear. So ux u0 depends only on x, v not only y. Then one can show easily from Hadamard equation that homogeneous order equation decompose into two Bürgersdorf equation in variable x and variable epsilon. And of course, with such initial data where epsilon equals zero, there is no any gradient catastrophe for each of them. But things may happen, change if epsilon different from zero. And one can see this epsilon sort of coupling constants between two dimensions. For this initial data, Hadamard equation are given here, and one can easily calculate T plus T minus solution of the homogeneous blow up hypersurface given by the simple formula. And one can easily observe the following fact that T minus is negative for all values of epsilon. So one may have only blow ups. Then branch T plus is positive for epsilon larger than one and negative if epsilon in this belong to this interval. Then one can easily calculate minimal time for gradient catastrophe in this case and will end up with the following formula. And one can see that one really has gradient catastrophe for this initial data for epsilon larger than one. So if we change epsilon from zero to one to infinity, what we can observe? For epsilon equals zero, there is no gradient catastrophe for both components of U and V. Okay, then for epsilon interval from zero and one, corresponding T is negative, so we have only blow up. In epsilon equal one, we have a sort of a degeneration of the system, but for epsilon larger than one, we have a gradient catastrophe. And then, larger epsilon is time of the gradient catastrophe decreases according to the following formula. Okay, in a similar manner, one can analyze more general initial data, which in fact resemble very much the standard initial data in one dimensional case, where u naught tilde, u tilde, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, arbitrary constants. And there are a number of various cases. I will omit it to discuss it pretty long. One can take a look on the paper if it's interesting. In all these cases, one is able, in fact, to do all calculations by the hand. And this is sort of advantage of the use of the formula of Hodberg coefficient proposed by Fairley. And it shows, in fact, that this approach, this formulation is really very useful in this case. It is equivalent to others, but that one, in fact, rather simple calculation done by hand. In some cases, it's difficult to do something by hand. For instance, for the full initial data of type of Gaussian, one can calculate everything by computer and calculate even the minimal time, present the form of the blow up hypersurface and do all that. Okay, now let's pass to three-dimensional examples with these notations. And let's choose the following particular initial data, which clearly are three-dimensional. Hodberg equation are given here. Matrix M, which is sort of derivative, final derivatives of F1, F2, F3, is of the following form. And one can easily calculate, write down the blow up hypersurface. One can easily see there is one real branch presented here. Remember, this is just three dimensional case. It was all already noted. In three dimensional case, there always exists at least one real branch. There always will be sort of blow up. And one can calculate here even that what has a gradient catastrophe for this value of t in this point. Second example, a little bit more complicated, given here, where epsilon again is a parameter which can change from zero to infinity, and from minus to infinity. For epsilon equal to zero, we again see just separation of variables, and three-dimensional homogeneous order equation is decomposed into three one-dimensional derivatives of equation. And one doesn't have any blow up or gradient catastrophe for such type of initial data in tangent, hyperbolic tangents. Hodberg equation for this initial data are given here, presented here. Not that simple, but more complicated by hand again. And one can calculate the blow up hypersurface. In effect, it's given by a very simple formula, cubic in T, which contains parameter epsilon. As I said, for epsilon equal to zero, homogeneous order equation is decomposed into three Burgers-Hopf equation. If epsilon two equal to zero, we have three branches here, which can correspond to each of these three Burgers-Hopf equation, as there is no gradient catastrophe at all. For epsilon different from zero, one can show that blow up happens on this value of u and variable x for epsilon different from zero, and corresponded t critical is presented here. So if epsilon is smaller than minus one, blow up happens for positive time, so we have gradient catastrophe for this initial data. For epsilon smaller than minus one, and then it continued to decrease for decreasing in modulus of epsilon. And one can write down other examples, and I think I do not have time to mention all that. I have, how many time I have?
You should just finish.
Okay, I will finish. It's two slides.
I see it.
Okay, it was a discussion of blow-ups and gradient catastrophe. One can, and my goal was just to show that in multidimensional case, there are several novelty and new properties which were not present in a one-dimensional case. And it was one attempt using the Hodberg equation of that type to discuss them. In addition, one can discuss view all this Hodberg equation as a sort of definition of maps of Rn to An given by the foreign formula. And T can be viewed as a parameter of deformation. So, on in other words, homogeneous order equation can be viewed as a system which describes the dynamics of RN to RN mappings with different properties. And in the papers, there's discussion of creation, regulation, singularity of mapping, connection, blow-ups, and comparison with the classical theory developed long time ago by Whitney, Arnold, and so on, and many others. And in the very end, I would say my congratulations, Andres, and best wishes for the next 75 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Maris. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you for the talk. And we have time maybe for one short question and one short answer.
So, by the way, thank you, very, very interesting talk. And I have a question concerning, is it possible somehow to analyze what will happen for gradient U or near catastrophe singularity? What can you say? How are they behaving in space? What kinds of singularity you have? Not only in time, so we understand that the derivative becomes infinite large, and the question is, what is the behavior in terms of coordinate? So what kinds of singularity you have?
Very good question. As I tried to mention here, if you take a look at this formula, you see?
This formula,
If you, in these directions, you have a quadratic polynomial respect to U, a linear in X. So it'll be, roughly speaking, square roots of variations. So derivatives will be, in fact, sort of as a square root minus one, X and minus one half, and so on and so forth. In contrast to one-dimensional case, there are some directions where everything is linear. And this is the point, in fact, we would like to address and to study, as it was done in one-dimensional case in the paper of, in the paper with Artensi.
No, in one-dimensional case, it's not a question. So it's written in, say, in some textbooks, of course.
Yeah, yes, of course. But there are higher order gradient catastrophe and so on. This is a question to investigate. In one-dimensional case, you see, there will be directions where the derivative will blow up. Other directions remain finite. Okay, yes. Now, what happens? Yes. Good question. Thank you.
Yes, yes. Okay, thanks.
Can I ask? My English is very poor and terrible, so I will give my ask in Russian, but at first, briefly in English. What your results corresponds to mathematical theory of catastrophe? Борис Георгиевич, вот по-русски уж я, боюсь, что непонятно, я говорю по-английски. Как соотносится с математической теорией катастроф конкретно? Вот у вас, скажем, n плюс 1 управляющий параметр. Вот мы берем формулу после преобразования годографа, и вы смотрите, какие градиентные катастрофы. Но мы же можем ли накладывать лишь n плюс 1 ограничение. С этим у вас какое-то соответствие наблюдается или нет? Вот так. Или вы за этим не следили совсем?
Что вы имеете в виду под ограничениями?
Ну а как? Вот на функции f. На функции f. Да. Вот. Мы для того, чтобы занулить там детерминант, для того, чтобы отображение было выраженным, ну согласно теории катастроф, вот сколько у нас управляющих параметров есть, столько и можем ограничений делать. Вот. А у меня такое ощущение, что вы как-то за этим не следили. Вот в данном исследовании. В других следили, а в данном вроде бы нет. Или я не прав?
Ну, вопрос совершенно правильный. Вопрос, дело в том, что здесь мы, у нас есть n функции f.
Правильно? N функции f. И n плюс 1 управляющий параметр.
Почему? У нас n параметр, функция f у нас параметр.
Нет, n пространственных переменных, еще временная одна. N плюс 1, все. И n плюс 1 ограничение, не более того, да, для описания катастрофы. С точки зрения этой катастрофы математической, и когда они говорят, что это ситуация общего положения. Да, вот так вот.
Во-во-во. Это вот, на самом деле, мы недавно с Джованни Артенси обсуждали это для одномерного случая. В математике говорят, что имеется n управляющих параметров. Для физиков функции f, они связаны.
Я выключу сейчас.
Можно отвечать? Они связаны с начальными данными. И физическая точка зрения, мы стараемся подчеркнуть разницу в том, что надо не обсуждать точку общего положения, а семейство начальных данных. И это всегда вводит в рассмотрение некоторое количество параметров. Это аргумент, на самом деле, Арнольда, который описан в его книгах. Когда речь идет о теории о сингулярности, там могут быть выраженные и невыраженные, стабильные и нестабильные. Но когда речь идет о семействах, то невыраженные критические точки, они неустранимы. То есть это означает, что разного уровня.
Когда вы имеете... еще дополнительные параметры. Понятно?
Конечно. Так и здесь. Функции F, они связаны с начальными данными. Мы смотрим семейство начальных данных, оно бесконечное. На самом деле у вас в запасе всегда есть бесконечное количество параметров. Как их выписывать явно? Да как угодно. Например, функция F вы можете представлять как полиноп, как и серии Тейлора или какие угодно серии.
I understood. Thank you. Okay. Еще совсем вопрос. Меня вот давно интересовали труды Николая Зубарева, у него много. Там тоже с точки зрения математической теории катастроф, по вашему мнению, все-таки подразумевается, что все-таки не общего положения, да, у него работы. Вот вы все-таки как-то ссылаетесь на него. Тоже точно так же, вот так вот прямо подразумеваются какие-то дополнительные параметры.
Нет, к сожалению, большинство работ, даже физической, которые видят, речь идет о общем положении, то есть полуматематических работ, математической физики. Физики настоящие всегда говорили, что всегда надо иметь в виду, что речь идет не о одном начальном данном, а о семействе начальных данных. И это восходит, я уже не помню кому, типа Пуанкаре утверждение, что если вы хотите понять физический эффект, недостаточно смотреть ситуацию даже если на общего положения. Надо семейство вокруг этого, тогда вы увидите характерные черты явления. Арнольд это многократно подчеркивал, мы пытались подчеркнуть. В этом докладе я это старался не упоминать, потому что это сразу же ведет нас к обсуждению градиентных катастроф более высокого порядка.
I understood. Thank you, Борис.
Okay. I'm sorry for answering in Russian also.
Well, thank you once again for the talk.